In its series of Sunday afternoon concerts, the CBC presents the second of two programs by Glenn Gould. The soloists in today's program are Julius Bake, flute, Oscar Shumsky, violin, and the distinguished countertenor Russell Oberlin.
Extraordinary things about history's most extraordinary musician is the fact that this man's music, which exerts such a magnetic attraction for us today and against which we tend to measure much of the achievement in the art of music in the last two centuries, that this music had absolutely no effect on either the musicians or the public of his own day. And the strange thing about Bach is that he doesn't at all fit our conception of the misunderstood genius who was years ahead of his time. He was certainly misunderstood, but not because he was ahead of his time, rather because according to the musical disposition of that day, he was generations behind it. To write a fugue like the one I just played was already becoming as old-fashioned in Bach's time as it would be if one were to sit down and start writing symphonies in the manner of Max Reger today. And Bach, as he grew older, not only made no attempt to reconcile his thought with the temper of his times, but in fact withdrew into what must have seemed to his contemporaries surely as a maddening nostalgia for the glories of ages past. For Bach, you see, was music's greatest nonconformist, and one of the supreme examples of that independence of the artistic conscience that stands quite outside the collective historical process. The age of Bach, speaking in a very general sort of way, was what we can now call the age of reason, or perhaps an age of reason. There have really been quite a lot of them. It was fundamentally an age in which man struggled against fear, against predeterminacy. It was an age in which he asserted confidently the wonders of science and of human initiative. It was at times an age of hubris, of defiance for the gods. But at its most poetic, it was still an age in which the wonderful utilities of science and the proud genius of man could coexist with the magical, mystical, fearful rites of belief. And so the art and the poetry and the music of the Baroque, at its best, is touched with this feeling of compromise, this conciliation between the will of man and the inexorable power of fate. But even during the lifetime of Sebastian Bach, this vibrant spiritual compromise, which gave such anguish and purpose and passion to his music, became for other artists of his generation ever more difficult to achieve. And slowly but surely, fact and logic, the explainable and the predictable, became the basis of philosophic premise. And by the time of his death, the world was a very different place from that into which he had been born. It was a world which longed to be logical, a world for young men and for young ideas.
Mm-hmm.
it was not he, but rather his sons who were considered to be the masters of music, masters of a music so very different from that which their father had known. It was they and composers like the teenager Joseph Haydn who were soon to lay the groundwork for a new musical style in which all of this scientific optimism, all of this naively logical philosophic thought of their generation would find a counterpart in an art in which the aim would be not the communication of man with God, but rather of man with man, in which those traits of Sebastian Bach which parallel in music the realization of the incredible richness and indefinable complexity of the human estate could find no place. It had become an age in which the focus of musical activity had moved from the church to the theater, in which the new art would rationally reflect a rational world, in which it would be required to deal with probabilities and not to participate in mysteries. This is not to say that the aspiration to transcend the human condition would be forever lost to art. Certainly it's the essence of Beethoven's work, for instance, that we feel him struggling to strike beyond the realization of human potential. But the grandeur of Beethoven resides in the struggle rather than in the occasional transcendence which he achieves. And it might perhaps never again be possible for us to own more than a glimpse of that inordinate state of ecstasy which Sebastian Bach never thought to question. And for a new age, new musical forms, the symphony and the sonata were the instrumental forms which this aggressive new humanity built to express itself. These were forms which were based primarily upon the simplification and the clarification of the system of what we call tonal harmony. And to these forms came a whole new conception of the role of the musical theme. They used the theme not as something which just was, which permeated every facet of a work, as it did in Bach's music, but as something unique, something singularly eventful, something belonging to the moment. This was also the age in which the concepts of a clear, symmetrical musical architecture became paramount. For Bach's sons, the theme was essentially an isolated event, related, propelled into a relationship, really, with other themes, other isolated events, by the device of what is called harmonic modulation, by the family ties of one key to another. And these family relationships were the background against which this new musical architecture built its structures. Now, Bach, unlike his sons, wasn't really searching for concise harmonic definitions for the joining relationship of themes. His harmony, his sense of architecture, was immensely complex, infinitely richer than that of his sons, really, and fraught with the kind of adventures that hadn't existed in the musical language since Gesualdo in the 16th century, and which didn't exist again until Schoenberg in the 20th. And while his son's music, with its symmetrical pleasure, its measured form, seems to relate somehow to the probabilities of a rational artistic creed, Bach's music, with all its eternally undulating flow of harmonic motion, with all its vast linear complication, seems to suggest somehow the suspended, perpetually transient, unknowing condition of man. One doesn't come to expect great surprises in the music of Bach. One comes across great moments, indescribable technical achievements, but one is not led to expect in the course of a work any moment, any pronouncement in which the whole work is not involved. In Bach's music, it's the constancy of event, the continuous line of development, the certainty of motion which we come to expect and to love. Essentially for Bach, art was a means of expressing that state of belief in which experience could be natively guided, in which only the obstructions and temptations of the world could thwart the immutable totality of existence, in which, however, the necessity to fend against these temptations provoked the drama of human life. It is these temptations and the constant effort which is required to expel them with which the text of the cantata number 54 is concerned. The title of this cantata, which Russell Oberlin is going to sing with us in a moment or two, Widerstehe doch der Sünde, roughly translates as stand firm against sin or something like that, and is very probably by Bach himself. Certainly its musical realization is given an intensely urgent and poignant expression. Its very opening chord is one of the most striking in all of Bach's harmonic arsenal. In fact, coming as it does at the beginning of a work, it's just about unprecedented. And both of the outer movements of this cantata are full of that wonderful and torturous art of intense cross-relation and suspension which Bach always reserved for those subjects on which he felt most keenly, most deeply.
Kennt ich Gottes Ehre schenken. Thank you. Fröhlichkeit davon, davon gemacht. Doch wenn man ihren schönen Banden mit Flöten andert, widerstanden, mit Böcke andert, widerstanden, hat sie sich klein davon, 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 hat sie sich klein davon, davon gemacht.
I think, to dwell at great length upon the descriptive qualities of Bach's music, despite the fact that they are much in evidence. Ever since the great Bach revivals of the late 19th century, an incredible amount of effort and misplaced scholarship has been applied in dissecting the dramatic connotations of almost every instrumental and vocal motif which occurs more than once in his work. In fact, in the most active years of Bach research at the beginning of our century, his cantatas and his passion music were subject to much the same sort of microscopic analysis as was the leitmotif technique of Wagner's Ring Cycle. Fortunately, we've now learned, I think, to accept the pictorial aspect of Bach's writing within its proper context. It was certainly an important part of his musical thinking, and one through which many of the characteristic motives of his instrumental style were adopted into his vocal writing, and vice versa. But there is a very real danger to be faced in overstating it. If, for instance, one applies the dramatic view to the opening phrase of the cantata number 54, you can say that the great tension of that dominant 11th chord, which is what it technically is called, depicts the tension and the discord of the struggle for the soul's purity, and that its tonic resolution portrays the state of contentment which awaits the spiritual victor. This is a plausible analysis. However, it would be possible to say, if one had the malice to say it, that the great tension of the opening chord represents the sacrifice and the nuisance of bothering the struggle, while the tonic resolution represents the ease and pleasures of sin. I don't think Bach subscribed to that view, but it does indicate that it's extremely dangerous to apply or to expect to have applied that kind of dramatic thesis in the music of Bach. Because the fact remains that Bach, for all the passion of his own belief, for all the conviction of his own theological position, was, insofar as his musical achievement be concerned, first and last an architect, a constructor of sound. And what makes him so inestimably valuable to us is that he was, beyond a doubt, the greatest architect of sound who ever lived. Bach's music provides us with the grand summation of all the techniques practiced by the great masters of North European music since the early Renaissance. He stands at the very end of a long line of German and Dutch and Flemish masters who tried to create harmonic vitality out of what must surely at one time have seemed the shrunken limits of major-minor tonality, which began in the early 17th century. Bach's harmonic thinking belongs to that concept of the tonal universe in which all of the anxious transition of musical history had been involved a century or two before his birth, in which this new system of tonality first proved victorious over the complex relations of modal harmony. Certainly all of the elaborate melodic techniques which Bach used were essentially those which had been developed and in some cases perfected by the great masters of the late Renaissance. In fact, Bach's linear devices, his vast resources of fugue and canon, were essentially techniques that required the widest possible harmonic references, techniques which would necessarily find the stringent economy of 18th century tonality a challenging but infuriating discipline. And one of the qualities which gives Bach's work its extraordinary poignancy is the fact that we can practically see him struggling to restrain the limits of his incredible linear imagination in order to fit and even to save the disciplining harmonic progressions of tonality. For Bach, as a German, stands between the two rival tendencies of early Baroque music, that of the north of the Dutch and Flemish tradition, in which the contrapuntal styles, the melodic developments of her work, were essentially based upon vocal prerequisites, and that of the south of Italy, in which the florid diversions of instrumental style were allowed to create their own sources of technique. Bach somehow managed to coordinate both approaches to the art of music. We find him, in his earlier years, writing fugues that had subjects like this one. Subjects which would be quite impossible to attempt to sing. But on the other hand, here's a fugue which Bach wrote the very year of his death, 1750. And in it, we can see that not only the harmonic style is infinitely more complex, but also that it would be possible to sing. This is music conceived in linear, in vocal terms. All of the tendencies which were rapidly crystallizing in the musical art of Bach's time were the exact opposite of that which is represented by that example and by this one, this glorious example from the art of the fugue. by no means all of Bach's writing is as intense or as arduous as the art of the fugue. When he adopts the instrumental principles of the Italian concerto style, he brings to them a certain stability, certain Germanness. They become in his hands as vital and as purposeful as that heartiest of the offshoots of the Reformation, the German chorale. If that sounds just vaguely familiar, that is not really a chorale I played. In fact, that, reduced to its harmonic basis, is the opening of the first theme of the Fifth Brandenburg Concerto. It's rather remarkable, I think, that even here, in this most sophisticated, most Italianate of the forms of Bach's day, the concerto, we find in the structural pillars of his writing that same harmonic purity and clarity of thinking which marks the great sources of German chorale writing. By the way, this little gadget on which I just played that fugue is, in case you're wondering, not exactly a piano and not exactly a harpsichord. It's a neurotic piano that thinks it's a harpsichord, and I'm going to close it now because it's also too noisy. That same theme, by the way, of the Brandenburg shows clearly, I think, the great differences in harmonic thinking that existed between Bach and his more progressive colleagues. The theme wanders constantly back and forth across the key center axis of D major, which is the key of the work. And each time we feel a conclusion coming on, something else happens to delay it. This is the sort of harmonic plan that Bach's sons wouldn't have been caught dead adopting. For them, the satisfaction of the musical structure was in getting through to the end, in termination, in achieving finality. For Bach, it wasn't finality that mattered in music, not really. It was simply the joyous essence of being. Thank you.
Thank you.